Happy anniversary. First and foremost, I want to just acknowledge Susan's outstanding leadership, her stewardship. It's interesting. Every couple weeks, we get together, all of the city department heads, and we every week get together in smaller groups. But as a group, 60, 70 of us get together, and it doesn't matter what the topic is, Susan will chime in and make sure she raises her hand and say, "Oh, wait a second, did you consider the rights of those with mobility issues, the rights of those that are visually impaired? Did you consider your responsibilities, your obligations, moral and ethical and legal as well, to include this and to include that?" So I just want to give a big round of applause to Susan and her leadership and stewardship of this department. She's outstanding. I want to acknowledge the other departments. I see a number of department heads here, and Ed Lee, Ed Reeskin, and others that have been doing great work and trying to lead the way and lead by example in terms of fulfilling our mandate, to fulfill our promises that we made some 20 years ago. It is extraordinary how far we have come, but it's equally extraordinary how far we need to go. And I want to underscore that we understand that. We understand that we are not there yet. We understand there's still discrimination in the workplace. We still recognize there's still accessibility issues on our own streets and sidewalks. Heck, there's even accessibility issues in our own San Francisco Board of Supervisors chambers, which still have not been made completely accessible. We recognize our rights. We also recognize our responsibilities. And so I want to just begin by making that point. I also want to make a few points about Ed Roberts, because it is absolutely right to remember that in 1962, it was Ed out here in the San Francisco Bay Area that led the way in so much of the progress that has been made, all not only around this state, but this nation and around the world, can go back to the work he initiated and the leadership he displayed in the 1960s. Don't forget, it was extraordinary. The headlines of the day, these were the headlines of the day when he was accepted to UC Berkeley. The headlines read, "A cripple is accepted into Berkeley." That was acceptable nomenclature. That was acceptable headline writing by the editors of local newspapers. That's how people were referred to. But it was because of his commitment, his constancy, his faith, his devotion to the cause of true equality that others started to come out, and others started to join, and others started to organize, leading to 1977. And many of you may have been there in UN Plaza, and how appropriate, UN Plaza. Remember, the birthplace of the United Nations, it started here, and the full promise of the United Nations all began here in San Francisco. And there, many of you were 100 plus strong in UN Plaza with the largest demonstration this nation had ever seen at the time, of people who said, "Enough is enough, and we're going to demonstrate our right to demand that our rights are extended." And people paid attention. And in so many ways, that was the cataclysmic movement, or rather moment in time, that really woke people up, so that some 13 years later, we woke up the nation when 3,000 people strong came out in Washington, D.C., Democrats, Republicans, independents, regardless of party lines, and we got the Americans with Disabilities Act signed by then President Bush at the White House lawn 20 years ago today. So it is remarkable, those origins. It's remarkable the progress. It's remarkable the work that all of you have done. Now, I was putting together, if you've ever watched, and maybe you don't want to, or never, yeah, maybe you had to, I'm never good with notes. I got my own learning disability called dyslexia, so I can't read very well. But I thought it was important to make Susan's point, and I'm actually doing something I never do. That is, I wrote some things down because I wanted to get this right, because I wanted to underscore what Susan just said about the last 6+ years. You know, when I first became supervisor, some of you may know, I hosted a little reception over across the street. And I wanted to celebrate the fact that I had the privilege of a lifetime to represent the people of San Francisco, and I was told I couldn't do it because I was at the green room across the street, and apparently it wasn't accessible, which was rather remarkable to me, because as a small business person, this same city hall made sure appropriately that when I opened my small business that it was accessible, only to find out when I came here that the same people that were telling appropriately small business men and women like myself what to do, they weren't doing it themselves. And I remember coming together and cobbling up a few bucks, and I said, well, that's ridiculous, because the city came in and said, well, it'll take years, it's an historic structure, all kinds of issues. And I just smiled. I said, boy, that's the same thing I hear business people say all the time, but we make them do the right thing. And so let me, if you can't do it, City Hall, I'll do it myself. And I actually wrote a check, and we put that temporary ramp, which, by the way, has now been made a permanent ramp, that's still there today, and made that chamber accessible. My point of saying that is not to impress you, but to impress upon you that I recognize when I got here as a supervisor, we had a lot more work to do than I could have ever imagined. So when I had the privilege of serving on the board, we worked to get more ramp taxis, we worked to focus on making sure the Olmsted decision was made real, we worked to make sure there are more accessible buses and pedestrian signals and the like. But when I became mayor, I had a little more leverage. And we had the benefit of Susan and others. And so here's just some of the things that we've done, just to highlight the point. We started with voting, because there's no more principal thing there. You know, in 2004, we made some progress, but just north of half our polling places were accessible with accessible voting equipment. Today, I'm proud to say, we're not 100%, but 95% of all the polling places now are accessible with voting machines that people can use in private, which is good.